I'm just a light boy looking for a lighter day, and it's a cold, wet Wednesday. We had days in the sun, but they added up to none. It's just the fate of the atomic age.
Well, good evening, everybody. Welcome to Lecture 31 for Physics in Everyday Life and Conceptual Physics. And we're getting down there in the last few weeks of the course. Hope things are going reasonably well for you wherever you are. And hope that these online recorded lectures are helpful towards your learning of the material for this class. I realize it's not the ideal. In fact, I was thinking about this particular discussion because in the live class version of this, we always started class by making a couple of samples of brownies in a mug that you can cook in a microwave, and then whoever's birthday was closest got a brownie to eat during the rest of class. So if that sounds at all interesting to you, if you just Google brownie in a mug, microwave, something like that, you'll find some places where they tell you how to do that. It's not the world's best brownie, but it is the world's best brownie that you can make in about 3 minutes. So last time we talked about radio waves and them being a kind of electromagnetic wave that consists of changing electric fields and then also magnetic fields that go along with that. Radio waves travel at the speed of light like all forms of electromagnetic radiation, about 300 million meters per second. And they don't require a medium to travel through, unlike other kinds of waves that we've talked about. We talked a little bit about two circuit components, an inductor, which is just a coil of wire, and a capacitor, which is two conductors that are separated by some space. If you connect them together, you can make something known as a tank circuit. And in a tank circuit, the charge sloshes back and forth in an electronic version of a mass on a spring oscillator that we looked at earlier this semester. And then based on the frequency at which that sound is going back and forth, you can drive a current up and down an antenna, and that will produce an electromagnetic wave that can be broadcast and then picked up by a receiving antenna. And the radio that we at least deliver to most car radios comes in two forms, AM and FM. AM is amplitude modulation, in which you are tweaking the amplitude of the electromagnetic wave that you're sending out to encode the information that you want to later be then changed back into the sound wave. Or you can do it with frequency modulation by changing the frequency at which the transmitting electron moves. You change the frequency in the transmitted electromagnetic wave, and that's how you encode your information in an FM signal. So next Monday again, exam 3 is coming up. It will be delivered online through the e-learning page, much like the quizzes are. You're encouraged again to make a sheet of notes for your reference and treat this like any other exam. Obviously, I'm going to have no way of policing that, so do what you will there, but you're encouraged to do that because studying for that and spending the time putting that sheet of notes together is usually actually a good way of synthesizing your ideas about the material that we've been talking about for these last four chapters. The exam is going to be online at the class time scheduled on Monday the 13th. So that's 2 p.m., our normal time that we used to meet back in Begeman Hall. But you do not have to do it right there at 2 p.m. if your schedule demands otherwise. There's going to be a 48-hour window until 2 p.m. on Wednesday the 15th where that exam is available. And once you log in and start your work on the exam, the system will give you 2 hours to work on it, or up to 2 hours to work on it, and you must complete the exam in one sitting. And so just plan accordingly for when you want to take that exam. I still plan to make it where you do not have to answer every question, but I don't believe you can actually make e-learning do that. So there will be a way for you to indicate within a given question that you wish to skip the question, you don't wish to answer that question. E-learning will probably give you a zero for it, but I will go back and remove those zeros and recalculate your score for that exam and change that in the gradebook. And the scores and feedback will obviously be released after the due date for the exam, so it won't immediately tell you how you did on the exam, because everybody's going to be taking it at different times in that 48-hour exam window. All right, so that's how we are going to run exam 3, and we'll see how it goes next Monday. For today, we want to talk a little bit about microwave ovens, which may or may not be a big piece of your cooking strategy here in these days of all the meals are at home. The questions we hope to answer in this exploration is, you know, broadly, how does a microwave oven cook food? What's going on, and how is it different from a conventional oven? What types of foods can you cook in a microwave, and what kinds of foods do not cook well in the microwave? Why do the microwaves include the turntable? And why do they have that screen on the door? What's going on with that? So let's revisit our electromagnetic spectrum that we've seen in a couple of these conversations. And so our microwaves show up right here in the middle of the sort of, I don't know, less the energy than visible light half of the electromagnetic spectrum. They are higher frequency and shorter wavelength than the radio waves that we talked about last time. But they are longer wavelength and lower frequency than things like infrared light, and certainly lower than visible light, X-rays, gamma rays, and the like. And microwaves is actually a fairly broad piece of the electromagnetic spectrum. Microwaves as a type of wave can get used for many things. They were actually used for communication systems several decades ago. But the microwaves we're largely going to talk about are the ones that are in most of our everyday lives, the ones that are produced by our microwave ovens. So if you dig around on your microwave oven, you should be able to find somewhere the power specifications for that microwave. So it tells you how much electrical power is coming into the microwave, generally what kind of circuit you need to plug it into. And this one happened to have a lot of, you know, dimensions for the microwave, both inside the cavity and outside, I suppose, for somebody that had it, was shopping for a microwave that fit a very specific space within their kitchen. But the pieces we're going to focus on are the power in there and the frequency at which it operates. So in fact, we're going to start off by doing a problem. The label, same label from the last slide there, shows typical information that's printed on commercially available microwave ovens. Yours obviously may be slightly different, but based on the information in the table, can you figure out how much current does the microwave need to operate and what's the wavelength of the microwaves? I would encourage you to pause the presentation here and try to solve those two on your own given the information in the label. If you get stuck or if you just don't want to work at it and just watch me solve the problem, you can click in the link there and that will take you over to the YouTube video where I do that problem solving. It's also linked in the announcement of this lecture. So now let's talk a little bit about what's inside your microwave. I don't know if any of you ever took the metal cover off of your microwave, but if you did so, you would see something like this. And there's five main parts of this system. There's a waveguide actually that goes over the top of the microwave oven. And you can think of that simply as the same thing as a system of mirrors would do for light. It's something to reflect the microwaves and send them down into the microwave cavity where your food that you want to heat up is sitting. There's a cooling fan. It turns out that producing microwaves is a fairly energy-intensive process. Most microwave ovens take a not insignificant amount of electrical current to work. And as they are producing those microwaves, they also produce a significant amount of heat. And so typically, when the microwave is in operation, there's a cooling fan that is also going on that is trying to remove as much heat from the surroundings of the core of the microwave that's producing the microwaves as it is in operation. The central piece of the microwave, and the piece we're going to talk about in a little bit more detail, is called a magnetron. It is the device that is producing the microwaves. And then you have some controls where you can choose how much time the thing is on for, what the power setting of the microwave is, and things of that nature. Finally, there is a transformer because you need to be able to change the voltage. Again, you're going to plug this in the United States to a 120-volt circuit, and you need to be able to step up that voltage to a significantly higher voltage internally in order to produce the microwaves within the magnetron. And we've seen and talked a little bit about transformers in a couple of previous discussions. So as I mentioned, the main core part of a microwave is, again, a tank circuit, very much like radio. And so you can see over on the left-hand part of the slide, the first image is that same image of the tank circuit from a radio, where you have a capacitor and then you have an inductor, which is a coil of wire, and that produces an oscillating current back and forth in that system. And that frequency of oscillation can be used when transmitting an electromagnetic wave signal in an antenna. Well, fundamentally, within a microwave oven, you have still a tank circuit. But the tank circuit is generally simply a horseshoe-shaped thing, a material that conducts electricity, some form of piece of metal. And the two ends of that horseshoe-like shape act as capacitor plates because they're two places that conduct electricity and they are separated by some distance. And then the back side of that is like a partial coil and a magnetic field can develop within that as current flows around the corner in that. And the end result of this is to make a tank circuit that produces a much higher frequency of oscillation than the quote-unquote traditional radio circuits that consist of a capacitor and an inductor. And so a real magnetron actually has several of these horseshoes. And so this image out of the Encyclopedia Britannica has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. It looks like 8 of these that are all arranged next to one another. And so simultaneously, you are putting charge into the system, and the charge is sloshing back and forth around these horseshoe-shaped gaps at a relatively high frequency. It goes back and forth generally in the hundreds of millions to billions of times per second. So that magnetron is embedded within some cooling fins to try to take heat away. As that current is sloshing back and forth at such a high rate, that's going to heat up the magnetron, and there is quite a bit of heat that's produced in that part of the system. So I've got my cooling fins. But importantly also, we're going to embed an output antenna within that magnetron, because as that current is sloshing back and forth in the magnetron, we would like some of that current to move up and down within this short antenna, producing the microwave radiation. Again, an electromagnetic wave with a higher frequency and shorter wavelength than the AM and FM radio waves that we talked about last time. So that's kind of the core part of a microwave. Now, what kinds of foods cook well in a microwave is a good question. And the short answer is foods that have a reasonably high water content. There's some other classes of things that work as well, but water is the key to most of the foods that we heat in a microwave. Microwaves do a great job, for example, at heating a mug of water to make tea or coffee or something of that nature. And in general, you may have noticed that foods that have high water contents heat well in a microwave. Dry foods do not. I've never tried this experiment, but apparently if you put like a saltine cracker in a microwave, it's not going to heat up very much when you try to cook it. So what does water consist of? Well, if you've had some chemistry in your past, you'll know that water from the periodic table consists of a couple of hydrogens and one oxygen. That's what we mean when we say H2O is another name for water. Well, how are those atoms arranged? Well, you take one oxygen and you add in two hydrogens and they form a water molecule, but importantly, those two hydrogens bond to the oxygen molecule in a way that they're not directly across from one another in this molecule. They form something the chemists would call hydrogen bonds, where electrons from the hydrogen are basically pulled towards the oxygen and spend more of their time orbiting the nucleus of the oxygen than they do the hydrogen. Well, that has a couple of effects. First of all, we won't get into this. It's fairly complicated quantum mechanics. I'm not sure I would be able to explain anyway, but they form a 106 degree angle with the oxygen, and that's a well-known and well-measured fact. So 106, you know, 90 degrees is your right angle. 106 is a little bit larger than that. So if you draw a line from the center of the oxygen through the centers of the hydrogens, those lines form a 106 degree angle. But the big thing we want for our discussion is the fact that those electrons from the hydrogen spending more time in the oxygen make the oxygen negatively charged, essentially, leave the hydrogen positively charged. And because of this, we have a what is known as a polar molecule, a molecule where one side is positive, the other side is negative. And that has important effects. You can see this, by the way, if you want to do this experiment at home. If you can go to the sink and get a small, thin stream of water going and then do something to charge a device, so, you know, rub a balloon on your hair or even rub a comb through your hair to electrically charge it. If you hold it near that stream of water will actually bend because of the electrical attraction to the object that you have charged and held near it. Well, within a microwave, that water molecule is going to be within an electric field. After all, electromagnetic waves, again, have changing electric fields and they have changing magnetic fields. So we want to think a little bit about what force or forces are on the water molecule when it's there in the electric field. So I've sketched a series of vertical lines to represent the electric field here. Here's my water molecule with the positive hydrogens and the negative oxygens. And so a positive charge within an electric field feels a force in the direction of that electric field. So there would be an upward force on each of the hydrogens. Similarly, there would be a downward force on the oxygen, and because the charge of the oxygen is equal, at least in the amount of excess negative charge, to the excess positive charge on the hydrogens, there is a downward force on that oxygen that's actually equal to the two upward forces on the hydrogen atoms that are part of that molecule. If you were to turn the electric field around, what happens when the electric field is reversed to the forces on that molecule? Well, if you guess that they're reversed, you're right. Again, positive charges feel a force in the direction of the electric field. Negative charges feel a force opposite to that direction. And so the direction of the forces flip on you. So let's think about this. And this is our first Poll Everywhere survey question for those of you that are answering those to get your participation credit. What's going to happen to a water molecule that's put in this electric field? Would it not move? Would it start moving upward? Would it start moving downward? Would it rotate now so that the oxygen was on the top and the hydrogen was on the bottom? Would it rotate so that the oxygen was on the bottom and the hydrogen was on the top? Would it do more than one of those things, or do none of those things? I see my copy and paste on the Google Slides on the recording is off. I will fix that before the slides you actually see and follow along with that. All right. Well, pause and answer if you would. The correct answer is that it will rotate in this. Think back to our conversation about way back when we talked about, seesaws or teeter-totters at playgrounds. When you have equal amounts of force on either end of something that can rotate, you can't, it's balanced. It's not going to go anywhere, right? But if one of those forces is down and the other one of those forces is up, the net effect is to get rotation. So in this particular picture, the positive hydrogens would be pushed downward, the negative oxygen would be pushed upward, and the whole thing would rotate counterclockwise, leaving the oxygen on top and the hydrogen on the bottom. So option D is the best choice there. All right. We're going to spend most of the rest of this discussion working with the microwave simulation. Again, this is a FET simulation from their previous generation of simulators. I still think it's useful for understanding what happens in a microwave. And if you are able to override the Java warnings on your computer, I would encourage you to actually play along with the simulation, figure out what's doing, and try to answer the questions that were on the worksheet. The worksheet was linked in the announcements. It's also linked on the Google slide here if you click on that image of the worksheet. After some initial exploration, most of the worksheet is actually questions that are also asked on the Poll Everywhere survey. And if it's not an option for you to play with the simulator, or you'd prefer to watch me do the simulation, that's what the YouTube video is there in the lower right corner. You can click there or on the link in the announcement and watch me go through the questions on that simulation worksheet. So, back to our original set of questions and see if we made any progress on this. How does a microwave oven cook food? Well, broadly, the microwaves, the changing electric fields in the microwaves, cause water molecules to rotate. And if water molecules are next to other molecules, water or otherwise, those rotations will cause collisions that will generate translational motion. More translational motion, more rotational motion means more kinetic energy and a higher temperature within the food. What types of food can you cook well in a microwave and what doesn't work well? Broadly, again, foods that have a high water content will cook well. Foods that do not will not cook well. Foods that have predominantly polar molecules do cook well as well. And I'm not enough of a food scientist to know, but I believe fats are also polar. And so you can get, high fat foods or oily foods to also heat up well in a microwave. Why do most microwaves include a turntable? Well, it turns out that as the microwaves are bouncing back and forth in that microwave cavity, they create a standing wave pattern, like we saw in our discussion of music a few weeks ago. The standing wave pattern means there's going to be places in the microwave oven where the microwaves are oscillating a lot. And there are other places in the microwave oven where the microwaves are oscillating little to no electric field change there, because you always have field or waves going against each other that are canceling each other out. What that means, and you may have some experience with this, is that as you heat food, certain spots in the food get really hot, other spots in the food are not as hot. If you let the food sit for a while, the conduction within the food itself sort of evens things out and makes the whole thing warm. But another way you can get around that is if you rotate the food as it's cooking, then your hot spots will not be in a fixed location and the food will heat more evenly. Finally, why is there a screen on the door? Well, the screen on the door is to stop the microwaves from coming out. But because the microwaves have a wavelength that is on the order of 10 centimeters, they get blocked by any sort of conductor that has openings that are significantly smaller than that. And so if you have small, less than 1 centimeter holes on the door of the microwave, it ends up allowing you to visually see in and get light going both ways through that door, but blocks the microwaves and reflects them back into the cavity of the microwave oven, and importantly, not out at you as your food is cooking. So there's a couple of YouTube videos put here if you want to take a look. In the first is a demonstration of a physics professor actually stopping the electromagnetic waves from reaching a radio antenna with something called a Faraday cage. So that's more germane to the radio discussion of last time, but it's the same actual shielding principle that's at work here in a microwave oven, because the microwave oven has a shorter wavelength than the AM/FM radio waves. You can get away with smaller holes in the shield that's blocking the microwaves from escaping. And the second thing, I thought this was fun, there's some folks that say, what happens when you take the door off your microwave? Is it dangerous to let those microwaves out? And so they shot a video in doing that. And if you want to take a look at that, you'd be welcome to. I also laughed because in the comments somebody said that they also probably killed the Wi-Fi of their neighbors. I do not know if that's the case or not, but it's kind of a fun thing to watch anyway. Finally, I went to Begeman Hall today and did a couple of the experiments that we typically do in this discussion on microwaves. So I'm going to go ahead and play that for you now. So we're here to show you in Begeman Hall a couple of non-traditional uses of a microwave. A microwave, after all, puts out electromagnetic waves, and you can use those electromagnetic waves to push currents, just like a radio antenna produces electromagnetic waves, and then they push charges in other antennas and create currents there. So I got my microwave. I came here to Begeman Hall because I don't think my wife wants me to do this with our microwave at home. And we're going to light a light bulb in a microwave. Not the light bulb that goes on when you open the door, but one of these light bulbs right here. So we'll try each one in turn. A little bit non-traditional. Let's take out the turntable. Right, so I got my light bulb and I'm putting it into a beaker of water. Let's see if we can get it to light up. And we'll try 5 seconds first. All right, got that light bulb to light up. That pushed an electric current through the filament, and it produces light. This is not obviously the most efficient way to light your light bulb. The whole point of the water at the bottom is just because the bottom part of the light bulb is metal and relatively thin metal at the edges. And so, as we've discussed, metal in a microwave is not necessarily a bad thing, but thin metal in a microwave is. So the water actually acts as a heat sink, so that as the current flows in the base of this thing, it dissipates any heat that it produces into the water as a result. So we'll try our oblong light bulb now. And again, 5 seconds seem to work pretty well.
Again, we get that light bulb filament to heat up as the microwaves are pushing electric current through that bulb filament. Now, CDs are kind of on their way out. I have a whole spindle of them in my office that I don't really use for much of anything anymore, but they are fun in the microwave, and this is a good demonstration of the thin metal within a microwave, because there is a very thin metal layer on a CD there. So here we go. We'll try 5 seconds again. And I don't think we're going to record anything on that anytime soon. It fries it in a little pattern right there. So if you want to worry your mom, here's some experiments you can do at home while we're on this shutdown.
All right, so that's it, everybody, for this discussion on microwaves. We talked a little bit about microwaves as a form of electromagnetic radiation. They take up a fairly good chunk of that electromagnetic spectrum. Broadly, that's the name we give to anything that has frequencies between 10 to the 9 and 10 to the 11 hertz. But because water, which is a polar molecule, meaning it has a positive side and a negative side, responds best, turns optimally when microwaves have a frequency of about 2.5 × 10⁹, so 2.5 billion cycles per second. That's what microwave ovens are manufactured to produce. And the changing electric fields in those microwaves cause the water molecules to rotate. That rotational motion causes collisions. The collisions cause translational motion. And all of that contributes to raising the kinetic energy and raising the temperature of the food. If you've not previously done so, I'd encourage you to look at section 12.2 in the textbook where Bloomfield is talking about microwaves. The chapter 12 quiz will be available starting at 2 p.m. on the 8th and available up until 2 p.m. on Friday the 10th. And if you want to look ahead for the Friday discussion, it won't be on Monday's exam, but we will move on Friday and talk about the first section of chapter 13. Stay safe out there, everybody.